the Committee on Community Resources. It's the March 20th meeting. And I will note that we have a quorum here today. I will also note that we're being audio and video recorded, and there is no public present to public comment. So we are going to move straight past public comment. The minutes are not quite ready to be up for approval yet, so we're going to not vote on the minutes, and we're going to go to our next and main or only piece of business, which is discussing the op-eds pertaining to the committee study request. Councilor Bidwell said, I hope everyone got them, I think yesterday, Councilor Bidwell sent around drafts of two op-eds that he's been working on. And he also noted, you can talk about it more if you'd like to, that there had been some hope that we could work on these outside of public session, but that wasn't the case by the AG's office.
Council President Dwight said that he thought that since all these op-eds were just reporting out what we had already deliberated on and the information that we'd already gathered in public meeting, he thought it might be that the actual, you know, reviews of drafts and editing to get something into a final product, that maybe we could still do that within the constraints of open meeting law. But no, the Attorney General's office definitely did not see it that way.
Right.
And they said they come across this situation all the time, and that it is what it is.
That's what it is. So we're gonna do this here and now as best we can. So is there one you want to start with first? Or?
Well, yeah, and I'll also say that I did talk earlier today, just by way of introduction, with Stan Moulton, the opinion page editor of the Gazette, and he would be very interested in two or three op-ed pieces. And the way I outlined them, I told them we had a committee meeting earlier today, but you know, at least an initial approach was for one to be just kind of a summary of a lot of the data that we gathered, some of which, you know, sort of refutes the notion that we have a downtown crisis. And then the second would be challenges and what our responses have been, and the third would be something along the lines of it's going to continue to be a vital and successful downtown, only to the extent that people make it that way, and here are four or five or six things everybody can do to pitch in. He liked it, and he said that he could run something next week if we had something ready by the end of this week, and that he could pencil in, you know, then a second one for end of May, and then a third one for the end of June. In other words, you know, one a month. So he's definitely, of course, he hasn't seen anything, but he's definitely interested in the concept.
Great. So you, one of the one on the overall local economy, it sort of ends up saying next week's upset, but it sounds like that's going to be it.
Well,
which would certainly work better in terms of us working on this.
Well, it could. I mean, the reality is that schedule would allow us to focus on the first one, knowing that the second one is still very much, and I consider the first one a little closer to being there than the second one, frankly. But we could focus on the first one if we wanted to get into this window that's available for next week, knowing that we would have another meeting before we needed to firm up a second one. I suppose we could think about it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Although, to the extent we can get, I'm interested in comments on both of them here today, but I think the priority should be the first one. Overall, the working title I gave it. They always, as you know,
yes,
put their own headlines in. But
right.
Overall, local economy envied by others despite challenges.
Okay. Yes.
So, two questions. You might have talked about these last week, I don't know, last month, when I wasn't here, I'm sorry about that. Did you talk about how would it be signed from the whole committee?
I did talk to Stan about that, yes. And he said that they always want one byline, and then a tagline would be either also signed by, or speaking on behalf of, or, you know, something like that. But they always want one.
Primary byline?
One primary byline.
Okay, yeah, I've seen them do that, so that's helpful. And then the other thing is, I was partly asking that as the leading question, because if I'm kind of signed on to it in some way, I would want to look at this in a pretty deep way, and I just didn't have a chance. I only got it in my email this morning and was at work all day, so I'm just concerned about, I don't know if we can do enough in this process today. And I'd like to actually, if we could read it out loud, maybe go paragraph by paragraph. That would be the only way that I would feel comfortable kind of signing off on something that's going to the press next week.
So there are, as I was thinking about this, it seems to me that the options are nothing goes until everybody is comfortable with everything, in which case it's essentially signed by all four of us with one byline. Or, and this is what the attorney and the estate attorney did, when I asked him, how do folks deal with this? And he said what he finds most often happens is that there's a meeting of the minds among a committee, and then someone is asked to represent that meeting of the minds and consensus and go off and finalize it and submit it. So that's kind of what we did with our report back to the council. I know this is different. We had there was a rough agreement on a draft subject to some discussed changes, and I was trusted to make those changes and then finalize it. Either of those would be options, I suppose, and I think part of it depends on what kind of timing we want to pursue. You know, do we? It's in terms of our work. It's the longer we go on, it's a little bit in the old news category. Although these issues are still very much relevant, whether it's now or next month. So. Mm-hmm.
If it's a headline, it actually supposes the pair, this one and the following one.
Right.
So you might want to just have one overall local economy and read by others, and then the next one would be about challenges, just if you're not printing
right.
them together.
Although, to the extent you ever have any control over what they'll, I do think it's important that we note, to the extent we can, up front and center, that yeah, there's a lot of positive indicators, but we absolutely recognize there are challenges. I think that needs to be,
it's either that or, because the way that it's written, it does not reference them except for the very last one that says, next week we'll talk about, so I'll cover reports. Yeah.
Would it be possible to have right below the title, to ask Stan if right below the title, it could say, this is the first in a series of articles that lays out a broad picture, a complete picture or something.
Yes, that would, because I am wary of appearing all just rosy without recognition that there are some issues here.
Right, no, I like that. It just sort of leads into the next, talking about the challenges.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I like the idea of having it be presented as a series. I don't know if they do. I mean, I'm trying to think of a series that was. I guess they are.
They do their own series.
Right, and do they? I think of them as more weekly, but I guess there are some that have been monthly. Anyway.
Yeah, I mean, and of course, the trick of it is that I'm not sure if, having seen just one of them, he would commit right then and there. I mean, in concept, he likes the idea of three of them, but I think he would reserve the right for an editorial decision one by one. You know, he's not gonna carte blanche say, okay, you've got.
Right. We could ask him though, right?
Well, we have asked. I don't think he can say any more than what he already has said. In concept, he likes the idea of all three. But without having seen two and three, I'm not sure he would absolutely.
That's why you write that it's a series. Well, he gets.
Well, that.
Whether or not he would agree.
I guess what I'm saying is, I don't know if he would write up front and say it's part of a series, having not seen the next ones. But we could. I would think that he would have enough trust in us, particularly if, depending on where we come out today, I could share with him the gist of what we think would be in number two or number three.
Maybe to be safe that each is more, you know, standalone and could, you know, don't necessarily infer too much about that another one's coming, just in case the series doesn't present itself the way we would like it to. Okay, so how should we proceed? Should we, Councilor Klein sort of laid out to either kind of go paragraph by paragraph, or then, or we could kind of give you general, would you feel comfortable giving sort of general thoughts, and let Councilor Bidwell make changes and then go ahead and submit it, or shall we go paragraph? It's not, I feel like we could at least get through one paragraph by paragraph perhaps, or give a shot, yeah.
So our aim is, just so we're clear on where we want to wind up today.
Right.
Because we do have other things to move on to, all of us.
Yeah.
To hopefully have arrived at, mostly arrived at agreement, with the understanding that there is still some data that I'm still trying to track down and stuff like that.
Right.
But to hope that we get to a rough agreement on this document, which subject to minor tweaks could go forward. Is that kind of what we're saying?
Yeah, I just want to note that the reason that I asked for paragraph by paragraph today is because I didn't actually have a chance to read this one at all. The other one is the one that I started reading, and that's the one that actually I probably will want more input into, because I'm concerned about some of the language that we had a little bit of controversy around on the committee. So I think I feel comfortable today if we can just read this aloud and just share general thoughts, having you, you know, wordsmith and craft the detailed language for sure. It's really the other one that I'm more concerned about. And that one, I can make all my notes in the margins and bring them to the next meeting.
Well, absolutely. And I very much considered the second one very much more of just a work in progress that would require a great deal more conversation.
Okay, so let's get started. Councilor Bidwell, would you like to read it, or would you like me to?
I should be familiar with it, so I'd be glad to.
Okay.
In a series of public forums organized last year by the Northampton City Council's Community Resources Committee, and in a wide range of reports and testimony before the committee, one theme emerged loud and clear. A local economy, particularly as it affects the downtowns of Northampton and Florence, though not without its challenges, is the envy of other communities far and wide.
Any thoughts on the first paragraph?
That's great.
Very good. Great.
Mm-hmm. I do note it's a run-on sentence. Okay.
But it's has it affix? Did you change?
Yes, I caught that. I caught the affix. Not yes.
I do try to make. Be consistent with the name that I give the committee, because as time goes on.
So are we the Committee on Community Resources?
Yes.
Okay.
That's my only input.
Okay. Noted.
And I don't think there's apostrophe S, I think it's just City Council Committee.
Committee on Community Resources.
City Council Committee.
Okay.
Committee on Community Resources, that's what we're called.
The Committee on Community Resources.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what our letterhead says.
Well, then that makes
sense.
And then next, should I go on?
Please.
Our committee, asked by the City Council to study the local economy and recommend ways to strengthen it, became convinced that abundant data simply do not support the contention of some that we have a local economy in crisis. alarming retail vacancies, soaring occupancy costs, unresponsive local government. Instead, actual data provide a picture of a balanced local economy, well-positioned to face the challenges presented by chain stores, internet sales, and the Springfield Casino targeted to open in 2018.
Okay, any help on that?
Okay.
Okay.
I guess I'm just looking at, you know, the dash alarming retail vacancies, soaring occupancy costs, unresponsive local government. I feel like the way that this gets expressed almost reifies the concepts more than kind of denies them, you know what I mean? There's a way in which, like, I almost feel like if we could do dash, you know, some people have expressed concerns about, and then say those things, something like that, just because there's a way in which the...
No, I
do you know what I mean?
I get your
how
point.
It kind of almost feels like we're saying, like, those are
It gives
realities.
These issues more, gives them, it highlights them at a time when we're trying to refute them.
Yeah.
We're defining the local economy in crisis.
And because they come before the positive stuff, it kind of packs this punch of
reifying
the concept.
So how about if we have a local, do not support the contention, we have a local economy crisis, period. In fact, actual data provide a picture of a balanced local economy, well-positioned, on, and then end with, this is hardly.
In fact, we don't suffer from alarming retail vacancies.
In fact, we do not suffer from blah, 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 blah. Yes.
Something like that.
Good point.
I'm a nitpicky editor and I know it, so
no,
I'm
that's,
getting really, really
no,
just
I recognize nitpicky when I see it, and that's not nitpicky. That's an important highlighting.
I'm gonna get you to write that for some of the people that I edit for. Yeah, I'm gonna get that right.
No, I'm sure some of the people you edit for, I would agree, that's nitpicky. But this one was not.
Okay.
All right. Third paragraph.
Data compiled by the city's economic development director, Terry Masterson, shows that in 2016, 12 new businesses opened in Northampton and that another 8 relocated within the city. And in parentheses, this compares with 11 retail establishments that closed, including, I think I might say, 2 of which were national chain stores.
So the point is net 1 business, right?
Yeah. Particularly noteworthy was the fact that 4, quote, landmark businesses, and I'm not sure landmark is quite the right term.
Yeah, I was going to ask you.
Yeah, I think there's a better word there than, or maybe anchor business.
What about just long term or something like that?
Yeah, or venerated or long
plus,
term.
I think I'm almost certain that 3 out of the 4, I don't know about one of them, were actually purchased by employees, and I wonder if transition to new ownership, just somehow that I feel like connotes to some kind of strength. That
well, I know, for example, I know we're probably thinking of something, Gazebo and A to Z were definitely purchased
by
former employees. Faces is a little more complicated a situation, and I don't know but I could certainly say, well, I can just research it, but since actually transitioned to new ownership, in 2 cases actually former employees or something like that. Mm-hmm. In a demonstration of confidence in the local business climate by the next generation of entrepreneurs. And then continuing on. Optimism in the city's future was also shown by the, I want to check on that number, but was also shown by $117 million of new developments initiated last year, spread between residential projects, market rate rental, affordable rental, condos, assisted and independent living, office, and retail projects. So instead of landmark, long-term, and we'll add the fact that in two or three, depending on what we find out, the transition was actually to former employees. At least those are the notes I made so far.
Yeah. I like landmark, but I'm not sure if it's... I feel like I like landmark. I feel like there's a term that is not coming to me for...
Well, it's not quite what an anchor is.
Right, it sounds really...
It's not quite anchor. It's not quite landmark. Long term is fine until I come up with something better.
Yeah.
Dennis, what does landmark mean?
Oh... They're sort of local institutions,
yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
You know, maybe there's
But I feel like any of those stores do fit that bill, and that, you know, people would come from out of town to go to these. They were sort of known.
You could say destination.
Yeah, I don't want to get destination as a very technical term in retail. Yeah.
I think landmark works. It says an object or feature of a landscape or town that is easily seen and recognized from a distance. Oh, that's right. Kind of. Marker, indicator, beacon. It's like a beacon. Yeah, I think that though that's
landmark
a good.
Might work. Maybe Suzanne Beck would have a.
As long as others don't feel somehow like it detracts from their businesses.
Mm-hmm. No, we're not saying other businesses are not landmarks. We're just saying other landmark businesses didn't change hands.
Right.
So.
Okay, historical importance. Of cultural importance.
Noteworthy, long-term. Landmark is maybe okay.
Yeah, I feel like landmark.
We're growing okay
with
landmark.
We've gone back to
okay.
Accepting landmark.
But if anyone comes up with the really right word, let me know.
Okay.
You're just getting, you know, titles again. Do we want to say the city's economic development or just plain data compiled by economic development director, because it's obvious that it's in Northampton. There's a couple of spots, this in the next paragraph, that refer to the city's.
Yeah.
I would
prefer to actually be sure it's the cities. There are regional economic development officials.
Right.
So mm-hmm. I think there the identifier would be appropriate, would be my opinion.
And people may not, there may be some people that don't know that we actually have a position in the city.
Yeah, I just didn't, okay.
But if you see other overuse of the word city, call it out.
It's more the possessive, the apostrophe S, yes, but I think it, you know, it works maybe throughout, so.
Northampton Economic Development Director?
But then you're saying Northampton in the same sentence.
Yeah.
So.
It is where we are.
Yeah, so yeah. That's, you know, more picky than we need to be.
Okay, and I want to double check that $217 million. I want to be a little more confident in what that does and does not include.
Okay, any other thoughts on that third paragraph? Okay, fourth.
The city's report shows a 6.4% retail vacancy rate as of December 2016 compared with 7.0% 1 year earlier. Parentheses, this contrasts with a national retail vacancy rate of about 12%.
I would just suggest that you don't put that parenthesis, because I think it breaks up the flow.
Done.
And it's very central to
the Done.
Okay.
Notably, 10 of the 14 properties that account for the Northampton vacancy rate are long-term vacancies, of which 6 are owned by one major Northampton property owner who pursues a business model that would be unsustainable for anyone else. I toyed around with considerably more pejorative ways of referring to our friend, but
there's just a typo there. Owned by one major.
Oh,
we have
yeah.
Own major.
Oh, right. I mean, I do. I I think bankers, folks in real estate would largely agree that what he's doing would be unsustainable for anyone else, but I don't know if that's the, if that's the right reference or not, but.
I would be fine with just having it, the sentence ended owner and not add the second part, which is sort of, I wouldn't say gratuitous, but sort of editorial. But
yeah.
I will defer to the rest of it.
Do others have feelings about whether to include some kind of reference?
I would agree with that because I think the following sentence, unfortunately, and again, I would remove the parentheses. I think that makes clear without it sounding editorial that there's kind of an issue with the way that he hit with his business model.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
Right. And that the city has tried to address it.
Yeah. I'm totally fine with it was a bit gratuitous. You should have seen how gratuitous the first part was.
So it's good to do some self-editing. Could you read that following sentence just if anyone's going to be watching this?
The final one?
No. So starting with unfortunately.
Oh, unfortunately, the city lacks the authority to force a property owner to rent or sell their property no matter how long it has been vacant.
I would say compel instead of force.
Yeah.
I was going to say I'm a little bit uncomfortable with saying unfortunately, but if we're removing the part of the previous sentence, maybe it's more necessary. I mean, I don't, whether it's fortunate or unfortunate, I don't know. You know, I think.
I don't mind it, but my own view is I don't mind it being regarded as unfortunate because Cambridge and Boston do have certain powers to intervene in situations like this that we don't.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to have a little more authority on, not that we would abuse it, a little more authority on, but.
I just think some people will chafe at the idea that the city council or the city would ever want to compel someone to do something with private property. although.
But just making the reference to the city's lack of authority in and of itself, you know, says that the writer considers it an issue.
So how, to what extent do we address it by leaving out
so
the unfortunately?
Just unfortunately and start
and,
it with
the. Just the city. City lacks the authority to compel. I think that's right.
Is that okay?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I know that takes a little bit of the punch out of it, but.
You know, that brings up a substantive issue for me, which is, if that's true, Councillor Bidwell, that there are cities that have ways of compelling people, why have we not discussed that as a committee and as a possibility in some kind of change in ordinance?
That is a very good question. Well,
I wasn't aware that there were cities that can't. That didn't.
I had a constituent pass on to me a Boston Globe article about a pending Cambridge ordinance. The old Brattle Theater in Harvard Square. It's been sitting forever. And that absolutely is a landmark. And the Cambridge City Council is considering an ordinance that would allow them to basically say, if it's not rented in 2 years from now, then we'll make our own improvements to the property and commence eminent domain proceedings.
Wow. Got a Baptist church that's been sitting there since.
Yeah, I can think of a few candidates for that treatment myself.
But that, I mean, certainly. But, have no idea if the city would be at all interested in taking out that sort of.
No, I think the history is that Boston and Cambridge, because of the very large number of nonprofit institutions, have exemptions from what are the zoning constraints of everybody else. But would it be worth devoting a little time to that topic here at some point and learning a little bit more about it, perhaps.
I'd like to see that on our agenda at some point. It's interesting.
That might be, you know, if we wanted to bring in the city solicitor. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure lawyers have or are checking over that. Wouldn't want to bring something forward that was going to cause an immediate legal challenge.
Right. I mean, if we confirm that there's just no way, then I don't know how much committee time we want to spend. But I do find it an interesting issue.
I mean, I know it's certainly been discussed. I don't know how deep it's been looked at.
Well, one problem of bringing it here would be we in fact raise an expectation that maybe we could do something about it, and I think that's a pretty long shot.
And that sounds like it's a targeted taking, you know, if they're talking about eminent domain rather than writing a blanket.
Well, the ordinance would be blanket. It would just be this one. This would be a property that it would apply to. No, it wouldn't. It would definitely not be an ordinance targeted to the Brattle Theater.
So does the ordinance say that once something becomes vacant, if it's not rented within 2 years?
I just sort of made that number up.
Okay.
That's the concept.
Can we put this on the agenda for a future meeting? For a discussion?
Yeah.
Anyway, thank you. I kind of diverted us.
No, it's a good diversion. And I will send around this article about the Cambridge situation.
Okay.
I guess there's a final sentence of that paragraph, isn't there? Most experienced observers regard Northampton's downtown vacancy and turnover rates as in keeping with the normal cyclical nature of such markets.
I just don't understand the term experienced observers. What does that mean?
Well,
experts.
Experts.
Making reference to the people we heard.
It's making reference to Wayne and Terry and Pat Goggins and other property owners who
people who work in the market.
If you prefer experts to experienced observers or.
And you want to, well, I think you would want to refer, if we're being specific about those that we heard, from whom we've heard. So the experts from whom we've heard.
Yeah, I mean, we could name them, you know, they're all.
Or we could just say the committee heard testimony from professionals in the field of, I don't know, like city planning and business development that. Something like that.
City planning and real estate.
The other way I should have framed this at the start was 750 words is the magic number.
How many is this?
And I think I'm closer to 800 right now.
Okay, so we're looking at
my experience is they give that 750, but they're pretty flexible.
Okay, so I'm not. But
it might depend on space, and they also will edit you, so
yeah,
you want to be careful about.
I say that only because I'm more interested in finding words to take out than to add. So
well,
I'm
already taken out half a sentence.
Well, there we go. Oh, yeah.
Couple words.
Yeah, of course we've added parenthetic for you too also. But, experts we heard from.
Our experts told us.
Experts told us.
Northampton's plan.
That was a typo in the turnover rates are in keeping.
How about a range of experts told us that?
Okay.
That Northampton rates are in keeping.
Yeah, so I think that would be helpful.
Okay. Is that sounding okay now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Can I make another comment that I just thought of when we talked about this last sentence is, would it be useful at the very beginning, and see I'm adding words here so that's going to be a problem, but would it be useful at the very beginning of this piece to say more than in a series of public forums, something like in a series of public forums attended by, you know, over 500 community, blah, 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 something like that, just so that we're making clear in this first piece that there was true engagement with the public.
To figure figure out how many people, and there are a lot of the same people.
That's true.
Thank you.
That's where in research.
In a series of
widely attended.
By members of the community or something like that, just so that we can reinforce that concept that this wasn't truly, you know, an event that had successful outreach.
Right. Okay, well, that's good. Okay, so we'll add that right up at the start.
Okay, sorry to.
No, it's all good stuff. It's all good stuff. Next paragraph?
Yes, please.
There are abundant factors that explain the relative success of the local economy. The five colleges, notably Smith College in Northampton, provide a significant anchoring effect to local economies, accounting for about $775 million in annual payrolls and approximately $15 million in local purchasing and procurement. Add to this the 10 museums in the area, seven associated with the five colleges, plus the independent museums that attract about 200,000 visitors a year, on top of the growing variety of arts and entertainment venues in Northampton. Additionally, local agriculture, and a culture and economy that supports it, grows healthier year by year. CSIS, which is Community Involved in Sustaining Agriculture, 274 Farms and Garden Center members benefit greatly from the nationally renowned Local Hero Program.
Can we say that local agriculture and the culture and economy that supports it is growing healthier year by year?
I think we actually can.
Okay.
I think the share of groceries sold that's attributed to locally grown in local markets is in fact growing every year.
Awesome.
I'm pretty sure that's the case.
You want to say anything about farmers markets or something here?
Well, certainly could. And
Farms, Garden Center, Farmers Markets and Garden Center member? Yes.
What is that referred to, Garden Center members? What does that mean?
That's the phrase CISA uses themselves. Mm-hmm. And maybe when you say CISA's 274.
What did you say?
Farms and farm related members, or I don't know.
I'm not sure that last sentence brings a lot of value.
You're not sure it adds a whole lot?
To the,
you could take out the reference to CISA. The Local Hero Program is a good somewhere to get in there. Maybe even in the previous sentence. You could fit local hero.
If you certainly say addition, local agriculture.
Supported by the Local Hero Program or something like that.
Supported by CISA's Local Hero Program?
Local agriculture.
Our vibrant farmers markets.
And
about that.
An economy. And economy supported by.
Do you think you need to define CISA? Do you think everybody knows what CISA is? Because it's a lot of words.
I know it is.
CISA's local view.
I think
we
general,
could even if they want to cut that thing.
That's
together,
true.
Right?
I think general journalism would say you probably the first time you use it would identify
right.
it. But
that's true.
Could you say additionally local agriculture and our vibrant farmers markets?
Local agriculture, how about supported by vibrant farmers markets and CISA's Local Hero Program?
Mm-hmm.
But then the next part of that sentence gets awkward.
Well, the next part of the sentence could go.
Mm-hmm.
Additionally, local agriculture supported by vibrant.
We can let you play around with that if you
want. Farmers markets and CISA's Local Hero Program. grows healthier every year. And drop the 274. That doesn't add a lot. So that would, subject to a little further tweaking, be something like, additionally, local agriculture, supported by vibrant farmers markets and CESA's local hero program, grows healthier year by year. Okay. And then, Northampton enjoys a healthy balance between strong locally generated economic activity and tourism dollars. That's not quite right. Figures on tourism spending from the Greater Northampton Chamber of Commerce, and this I'm waiting for some data from Suzanne. They've just released, not yet in, well, I don't know if they put it out in a report yet. They're going to do it this week. They've analyzed all these credit card spending from the Visa has made available, and it gives really hard, a really good look at actual numbers. And she talked about some of them at the chamber annual meeting back a couple of weeks ago, but I haven't seen them. So I would like to, if there really is some good data there that sort of fits with the flow, I'd like to insert it, but I don't have it right now.
Okay.
But in concept, is that making sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
If you want to save space, I don't know if you need to explain the, based on an analysis of Visa charges from cardholders, but I guess you're trying to make the case of how they're long distance people, right?
Yeah, and that will probably change when I actually see it. That's my recollection of the way she described it. So I want to get more accurate there, but that's the gist of it.
Did you
want to
work on that first sentence, or
it just struck me,
or tourism?
A strong balance between locally generated economic activity and a tourism economy would be.
Okay. I don't think you need to say between. I think you can say of.
Healthy balance of.
That's wrong. Mm-hmm.
It doesn't save a word, but it does save letters. The balance of strong words you have to the end.
Between just makes it too dichotomous. As
you're right.
I thought, yeah.
Okay. Then, if we're okay going on the next one, hotel tax revenues to the city declined only slightly in 2016, down 4%, despite the closure of the 100-room Clarion Hotel. And though some restaurant owners have reported declining revenues, meals tax revenues overall in Northampton in 2016 were up 1% over the previous year.
The only thing I would say is, I don't know how much these fluctuate, so I don't know if 4% would be considered only slightly or not. I mean, I understand that's in the context of
right.
A hotel closing. That's the only thing that I would.
Whether the sort of editorial comment of only slightly, or whether, you know, it declined, could say declined just 4%, although that has the same implication, I suppose.
Yeah, but it's a little bit different than saying only slightly, where, you know,
declined.
Things don't change much by percentage, then 4% could be more than, you know, declined only by 4%.
Declined just 4% despite.
Yeah.
Okay. And though some restaurant owners have reported declining revenues, meal tax revenues overall in Northampton were up 1% over the previous year. That's straight off of Terry's.
What does that mean, that people are just spending more?
Prices were more.
Well, Of course, you could say 1%, but that's just inflation. It's pretty, so it's pretty, in other words, it's pretty flat, but it's not declining.
Right.
Which is the, which is.
And we definitely heard from people who said it's flat.
Oh yeah, and we heard folks say for us, it's down. And there are obviously are some. And then there's some that gone out of business, but overall.
The revenues to the city are up 1%.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Yep.
You know, what Maureen just said, I like that framing because I think it's clear for those of us who are not very economically oriented, just to say that the revenues for the city are up. So somehow maybe changing that language a little bit, instead of talking about meals tax revenues overall, that revenues to the city are up by 1%.
The only thing I would say about that is it sort of takes the emphasis off of the businesses and puts it on to the city, you know what I mean? It's talking about how the city gains from that as opposed to talking about the impact to the business, which is just sort of, it's just a different framing of it. Framing, I think we're more interested in than perhaps they are.
Yeah, well, when you talk about meals tax revenues, anybody that knows what that means, it means the city's getting that anyway, but yeah, right. Or at least the state is.
Well.
That's fine, I just, there's something when Maureen said it, that it just, it packed some more of a punch for me to, for people to understand the city's, but yeah, that's fine. Sorry, being a little picky again.
Oh, it's all right. Are you okay with it?
Yeah, yeah, I actually don't think I said it much differently than the way it was written, but.
Okay. And next, though the resilience of Northampton's economy is largely due to the risk-taking and commitment of local business owners, the city itself has played an important role. A long-standing commitment to a unified property tax rate, meaning commercial properties pay at the same rate as residential properties, and the ability to keep a tax rate among the lowest in the region has kept many businesses in Northampton and attracted others. And by the time phase two of the city's Pulaski Park renovation and expansion is complete, a total of almost, and I think the number is 3.4 million in public funds will have been invested in the heart of downtown.
Is that just the numbers invested in Pulaski Park?
Mm-hmm.
What about, I mean, is there investment in, is there other downtown investment we can add into that number? Like the academy?
By then, there may be also other road stuff coming.
Well, just to put this in time frame, the by then is if we want, you know, the next couple of days, we've got to wrap this up. If this is going to go in.
Oh no! I was talking about the by then related to the and the infrastructure work, the other work.
Right.
By the time Pulaski Park is done.
Right.
Although I think that would be done before other road investment, but certainly there, you know, there's been investment in the academy.
I know. There has been, and let me. I agree. We can make it bigger.
And I mean, we're not just trying to make it bigger just for the sake of bigger. It's, you know, I think there's value in pointing out
yes.
the investment that has been made downtown.
And then the next sentence would be also the combination of the new roundabout of Pleasant Con Street and the upcoming streetscape infrastructure improvements to Pleasant Street represent an investment of almost something in upgrading this critical gateway, I don't have to say gate, entrance, gateway to the city. So there are some numbers. I agree. We should make it more inclusive than just Pulaski Park and see what that number is. And need to get a good estimated number for the roundabout and Pleasant Street work.
Right.
So provided that we track down those numbers is
I imagine that, Wayne could give you a
yes.
Yeah, I think that's a great
that sounded okay.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
And then I absolutely welcome your help in the final sentence. I don't think I've nailed it here. Assembling all this data paints a picture of a healthy and balanced economy, emulated by many. But does it have challenges? Absolutely. Next month's op-ed will cover, and that's where we would do a segue that would both acknowledge we are very much aware of challenges and tell folks that that's what's coming next, a discussion of those.
I mean, I wonder if it could just be much more vague and say, absolutely, you know, we hope to publish a op-ed in the coming weeks that, you know, details some of the issues that we
are. Right. If we had enough confidence in what we thought was going to be in the second one, then I would argue we should provide some specifics, because I don't want folks to say, you wrote 750 words and didn't even mention wage theft, which so many people came and spoke about, and you didn't even mention the downtown population and panhandling. You didn't even mention, you know, so I, to the extent we can fit it in the word, I think there should be some some acknowledgement of quite specifically, here are the challenges that we've been thinking about, we'll talk about next month. But
you might want to bullet point them a little bit more just to save words, if possible. Not literally bullet point them, but just have less verbiage there. I don't think you mean emulated by many, do you? Do you mean envied by many? Emulated means
I do mean envied. You're absolutely right. I mean,
and the only other thing that came to mind, and again, this would add words if you're going to tackle any of these things, but we don't mention the DNA, which I feel like is kind of important, and they'll feel a little slighted if we're talking about all the positive stuff that's going on.
You're right.
Very good point.
And I wonder if we can also figure out how, in very few words, to just talk about some of the events that happen that bring vibrancy to downtown, because I think that's something that a lot of people know about and see as something that's a marker of a success.
Well, how about this? In that 2, 3, the fifth paragraph back on the first page, the one where that ends with the agriculture reference. He says, on top of the growing variety of arts and entertainment venues in Northampton, with leadership from the DNA. Of course, when you start naming names, then, well, you know, what about the Arts Council?
That's a good point, because all of those feel very...
I know, and
you know,
and
Penny's
and,
gonna,
and they all have their...
But we're very specifically not, I mean, there's sort of a plan to talk about the arts more in depth than another one, hopefully, right?
Right. But nevertheless, folks will respond to what's on the printed page on just this one. They won't say anything. Oh, they left me out, but I'm sure they'll cover me next time. There's another way to get at this.
Can you just ask Dan if you can have the whole page?
Yeah, that's the way to get at it. What's so magic about 750 words, Dan? Well, what we could say is back where we're talking about the city itself has played an important role. We can say the city joined with this is where you have to, if you're going to mention the city, you have to mention the chamber. If you mention the chamber, you have to mention the city. I've learned that they both want to be regarded as having made the DNA happen. But you could say the city joined with the Chamber of Commerce to stimulate the organization of the DNA of the Downtown Northampton Association.
You just said to create?
To create. I know. That would be a place.
And I think in terms of other arts things, all you need is two more words where it says, on top of the growing variety of arts and entertainment venues, I would say venues and events.
Yes.
And special events or something like
venues,
that.
Venues, events, and festivals, even, to make it sound festive.
That also would include first night and just all kinds
yes.
of things.
Hot chocolate run.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we'll add that reference to events and festivals back there where we're talking about arts and entertainment venues. And the paragraph where we're talking about the city, add the city joined with the Chamber of Commerce to create the Downtown Northampton Association. I do want to give them a boost whose work has already made a big difference to downtown, or words to that effect. So that would leave us back with is that the right way to end it? Assembling all the data about paints a picture of a healthy balance kind of anyway, and it does have challenges, absolutely. And then, Elisa, what would be your suggestion for a more compact way of ending it, giving a teaser of what's to come, but saving words, if that's what you were suggesting?
I mean, just really simple things like reports of wage theft, you don't have to say in the restaurant and construction industries.
Right.
What about just saying something like homelessness?
Mm-hmm.
Concerned about and the associated issues of panhandling. This is where we're starting to get into
the
questions.
We got to the final sentence.
Not all of us see it as an issue, so.
I know, but I would argue just based on the number of, and went through and quantified and looked at people that had spoken to us about what, regardless of what any of us think, I think it's fair to say it was identified as an issue. That would be my own take on that.
The way that sentence is, it refers to it as an issue associated with the challenges. So it says the challenges facing at-risk populations.
Including homelessness and the associated.
So that's one challenge, including homeless individuals. And then the associated to the homelessness? It refers back to the at-risk population.
It refers back to the at-risk downtown population.
I think that would be sufficient for this as a teaser for what's coming next. Just say either homelessness by itself or at-risk downtown populations by itself.
I would be concerned that though we have been careful with our language, there's an awful lot of folks who are very much concerned about what they call panhandling, and we've just heard that. We can nuance it and be sensitive about it in the way we write about it in some depth in the next piece. But it just I would argue that we can't ignore the fact that folks have talked about it a lot, and that's the word that's used in addressing their concern.
Well, here's the issue. It's kind of like you say reports of wage theft as opposed to just wage theft, so that that attributes the concern to the people who expressed it. Whereas with panhandling, if you just name it as panhandling, you're not attributing it to the people who express it as panhandling. So that's kind of an inconsistency that, again, kind of reifies this concept of panhandling as an issue, as opposed to naming it as something that other people have identified as an issue. You know what I'm saying? And that was part of what I was going to talk about in the next one is, you use the term alleged, which, other than the fact that that's kind of a legal term, it's, you know, you can say people's experiences of wage theft, so that we're giving them the weight of the reportage, as it were. So it's just, I'm just trying to say, let's be consistent in that way. If we're going to attribute something like wage theft to the people who claim that they've experienced it, claim that it's an issue, let's do the same with panhandling. Does that make sense?
And so what would
after you, what you do is after including homeless individuals,
or homelessness.
Including homeless individuals, you'd put probably a semicolon there, and then in the next clause, just make it a somehow, if you want to reference panhandling, do it in such a way that it reiterates that for some people it's an issue. Because the way it's written now is it's a given that the issue of panhandling is a challenge facing the city. Whereas I think what we want to talk about is it's a challenge for some, or it's an issue for...
How about, I mean, if you're going to say reports of wage theft, reports of
that might
discomfort
work.
With being solicited, or discomfort with...
Expressed discomfort, something like that? Expressed concern?
Yeah, I think expressed concern about...
And, you know, I say the city's response. I'm not sure we need to say that. You know, reports of wage theft, semicolon, the challenges facing it.
Well, you definitely don't need to say it in both places. So maybe if you want to say the city's response, save it for the end, and the city's response to all these, or something like that.
Okay. So, depending on what Stan has to say, it would say next month's op-ed will cover, or guest column, or whatever he calls this. Reports of wage theft, semicolon. The challenges facing at-risk downtown populations, including homeless individuals, semicolons. Expressed concern about panhandling, semicolon. Opportunities to do an even better job of coordinating and promoting arts events. And I'm not sure we need to say the city's response at all.
I also don't think we need to include all of the challenges facing at-risk downtown populations, including homeless. It's
too much?
Really what you're doing here is you're just kind of giving really brief bullet points
right.
of what, and that's, it just seems unnecessary to me.
So you can take out including homeless individuals, because they fall under
at risk. Yeah, I think so. Okay, that would simplify that. And do you think we should end with a reference to the city's response, or is that just sort of implied?
You could say next week's op-ed will cover the city's engagement with reports of wage theft, da 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 da.
Yeah.
Or we'll cover the city's response to.
Mm-hmm.
Would that, that would do it, wouldn't it? Next month's op-ed will cover the city's response to reports of wage theft, semicolon. The challenges facing at-risk downtown populations, semicolon. Expressed concerns about panhandling, semicolon. Opportunities to do an even better job of coordinating and promoting arts events, and period. But do an even better job to be even more effective at. Would that sound
yeah, seems like a lot of words that last part.
Opportunities to be.
What about just arts promotion?
Or more effective at. At promoting arts events.
Pretend you're on Twitter.
Yeah. Yes.
Do you tweet, Dennis?
I have resisted temptations to tweet.
It's a really good experience for figuring out how to shorten everything you say.
Yeah, it is, but well. Are we about there?
I think so. I feel comfortable with where.
So that there's some fact checking to do, some additional data to track down, and then I think I've got pretty good notes on what we've agreed on as edits here.
See,
so
we
much.
Did it.
Absolutely.
I mean, one.
Yeah. We should quit while we're ahead.
To that point, I have some time constraints today, so I don't think that I would be able to stay to go through the whole second one. And it sounds like you would like more time to look at it more in depth. So how should we proceed? Should we wait and talk about this at our next meeting? If you hear from Stan that he would like this to move more quickly,
I doubt that's the case. He was pretty clear about next week would be last week of March, and then last week of April, and last week of May.
Okay.
As when we want to run these.
Perfect. As long as you feel
like
you have enough time to go back and edit to get them in on time. Based on our comments.
Right. So our next meeting is scheduled for Tuesday, April 18th at 6 p.m.
Right.
As I think we've tried to come up with a.
Just want to make sure, because I know that's an odd time. That's
right, it's an odd time and an odd day. Because usually it's a Monday, but that Monday is Patriots Day.
18th at 6 p.m. Yeah, I did.
Right. Now, as I think we talked about last time, that is school vacation week, so I actually may not be here for that meeting. Could I send you edits that then are discussed
one person.
Or send Pam edits? And then.
I think one person can send me edits.
Okay.
That's not a quorum. Amongst us four.
Okay.
And then after that, everything will be
right
here. I think so.
Is everyone comfortable with that? Is anyone concerned they might miss that meeting and we wouldn't have quorum, in which case we should try and find another day? I feel like we did try and find another day and failed,
yes.
Which is why we stayed with this date,
even
though I think there's a good chance I will not be here.
There's a chance that I'm going to be away too, just because it is school vacation week and my partner is a teacher, so it's when we get to go away. And we also have city council that night, that Thursday. So it would be towards the beginning of the week that I would be likely to go away.
Me as well.
Well, that sounds like maybe we should go back to drawing boards if we're likely to have
to try and find a new date.
Try and find a new date?
Yeah.
A new date in April?
Okay, so let's give this another shot.
Wow.
did you guys look at the week before?
We must have.
I feel like we did, but let's do it again.
It's Passover.
Monday, April 10th, I have legislative matters at 5.
Passover.
Okay. And city services at 4.
Okay. There's no overlap between those two. There is overlap between those two. How's that going to work?
City services and
legislative matters. Ryan's
who is? Oh,
Ryan's on both.
Oh, I don't know, because we moved it to, our meeting's at 4 and your meeting's at 5.
Right.
So we just
will finish. So you think it's just going to be done?
We'll just, that would be especially.
I think we're hearing from the mayor about the appointments process.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
What about Thursday the 13th at 6? I have a sustainability commission meeting at 4, but I could be ready by 5:30.
I could do that.
I can't do that if that matters to you.
Oh,
you don't have to have the meeting with me, but I have a commitment on the 13th. But, you know, you guys can still have the meeting and tape it, and I can.
It wouldn't be the same.
And
Tuesday is not good, the 11th.
Okay, but.
You're not getting out that easy.
Tuesday's hard for me because I'm probably going to be in Boston for Passover.
Oh, I see.
I can't do that Wednesday.
I can't do Wednesday either.
But that Thursday I could do, if all of us can do it, and if it's okay with you, Pam.
If you want to do it, can you do anybody do it during the day?
On Thursday?
I'm tied up in Springfield, actually, up until about 2.
I could do 3 o'clock.
How late?
Except I have energy and sustainability at 4.
No. Yeah.
And we also do that in this room.
Yeah.
I mean, if we could 2:30? Do 2:30 to 4, 2:30? That would work for me.
I could do that.
If you could be here on time, right? Does that work for you?
I think I could do that. So I'm taking it away from the 18th and I'm making
it. So the 13th at 2:30.
Thursday, April 13th, 2:30 p.m. here, I think. Great.
I'll let you know if I have to change the room because there's usually nothing going on during the day, but maybe off chance that there might be.
Great. We don't have to worry about not having one.
And that gives Councilor Bidwell, you can have more time to incorporate our edits before you have to get it to the
It's
set.
True. I
feel like it gives him less time, right?
No.
Well,
it's in April. Is when he has
I mean, less time between now and then, but more time between then and when they would probably publish.
Got it, yeah.
Just, can I go one final thing on this? So, just so we're clear, so this would be, I'd be the byline as, well, I don't know how to do it. And then I guess down below, it would say vice chair of the committee on community resources, and this co-signed by, or how? Is that what we're comfortable with? Or on behalf of, or co-signed by, or right on behalf of? I know they've
I'm sure
got,
that they have
they've got certain preferred, but,
yeah.
But any of those the is generally okay with you? Co-signed by, on behalf of, whichever they...
Yeah, however they do. I know that they do have a way that they do.
Okay.
How about micromanaged?
Micromanaged
by, with our names.
Authored by Councilor Bidwell, with the nitpicking assistance of...
Micro-edited by...
Always
a lovely word.
Okay. So thank you for all of that work.
Thank you.
Well.
Yeah, thank you
for that
so
excellent
much.
Excellent writing. Thank you.
Thank you for the
us
all
for
that.
Writing that, please.
Yes. No, well, I must
you
say
you guys did boil down to 750 words.
Well, thanks, Pam, when you put it that way. That's not true. Times like three op-eds. So.
I have to say that I there was a little bit of trepidation as Councilor Sharon's in mine. Oh my God, editing by committee. I must say, I think everything that was suggested was really quite good and helpful.
I'm proud of us as well. Yeah, we did it. I'm proud of us.
We did this in some, what other, I was with you on some other committee where we did this and we had the same kind of feeling like, oh,
how are we possibly
doing this? And it actually worked out well. What was that?
Yeah, we're all just really pretty
first. It's just reasonable.
Okay, so anybody have new business? We covered the date question that I wanted to discuss, so nope, no new business. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
No objections? All right, thank you, everybody.
Okay.